Hello everyone. In this session, let's focus on the numericals more specific to the interest rates. Right? We have looked at the theoretical aspects for interest rates. We will focus on solving a couple of numericals on these things so that we get a comfortable ground in terms of understanding the scenarios, especially the force of interest related problems. Look at this example here. We are talking about a variable force of interest, wherein we are saying that for up to 5 years, 0 to 5, the force of interest per year is going to be something like this. It's a continuously compounded rate of interest, but probably we are seeing that the continuously compounded rate of interest is constant above 5 years at the rate of 5%. Now, my intention is, if at all I'm going to receive 1,000 at the end of 17 years from now, going with this kind of expected interest rate patterns, thinking that the interest rate patterns for the next 5 years are going to be something like 0.04 plus 0.02t, which is continuously compounded, and 0.05 continuously compounded after 5 years. So, how much should be deposited today, if that is the kind of a requirement? So, basically, it's finding out the present value. And we have said the discounting factor, probably it is nothing but 1000 into e power minus delta t. But that would have been the case if delta is constant for the entire period, for the entire 17 year period. Probably if delta had been constant, I would have taken it as 17 times whatever is the delta t, probably 0.05 or whatever it is. This is what we would have considered. If it is 5% continuously compounded for the entire 17 year period, this would have directly become the present value. Probably let's see this. If it had been the same 5% across, then the present value would have been 1000 into e power minus 17 times 5%. So typically it would have been something around 427. So if I deposit 427 and I'm getting around 5% per annum, continuously compounded kind of an interest rate, then that would have been boiling down to a total of only 427. That would boil down to 1000 at the end of 17 years. But here, the way we are looking at the interest rates is slightly different. We are saying that between 0 to 5 years, there is some kind of variability in the interest rates. If that is the kind of scenario, then we have to use our concepts of integration. So basically, if at all I want to find out the total present value, right? The way we should approach is, I want to find out the present value or a discounting factor for any period greater than 5 years. So how do I find out e power minus integration of between 0 to 5? We know that the interest rates are 0.04 plus 0.02t. Because I am integrating it, I'll use another variable s, ds. And we also know that if at all I'm talking about between 5 and 17, or let me make it more general, between 5 and t. So either I would be multiplying these two or adding at the power level. That's okay. E power of 5 to t, whatever is the t, e power minus 5 to t, let's talk, we can substitute 17 later, this becomes 0.05 ds. Now, using this is what is probably I can add up at the exponent level, but keep that aside. So I can very well find out the integrals. Okay, for this part, minus I am taking out. So 0.04 will become 0.04s plus 0.02 into s squared by 2. This entire thing is integrated between 5 and 0. Whereas the next part, which is e power minus 0.05, is a constant. So the integration will lie as 0.05s, which has to be integrated between t and 5. So this can very well be multiplied, or probably I can add them at the power layer. Fair enough. Now we'll try adding at the power layer. Now substitute 5. So the first part, this part typically simplifies to e power minus, if I substitute 5, it becomes 0.02 plus 0.02 into pi squared by 12. Right, s is 5, sorry, it becomes 0.2, not 0.02. And this becomes 2, so this becomes 0.25. 25 by 2 into 0.02, it becomes 0.25. So the left hand, the first expression typically becomes a constant, which is e power minus 0.45, which is the discounting factor for the first 5 years. Whereas in the next 5 years, it is working out to 0.05 into t minus 5. Because t is a variable. If I take it as 17, then it becomes 17 minus 5, whatever it is. So on simplification, probably this is coming out to e power minus 0.45 into e power 0.05 t into e power minus 0.25, right, which is working out to e power 0.05 t e power minus 0.05 t minus 0.2, right? Minus 0.45 into minus 0.05 t plus 0.25, which is working out to this. So probably you can very well simplify for any kind of t which is beyond 5 years. The present value is nothing but e to the power of minus 0.05 t minus 0.2. Or plus 0.2, sorry, e power minus of 0.05 t plus 0.2. So given in this numerical, we want for 17 years. So I'll take it as e power minus, I don't need to do integration anymore, 0.05 into t, which is 17, comes out to 0.85 plus 0.2, which works out to e power minus 1.05. So the discount factor in this case is e power minus 1.05. Let's see what it works out to. So the 1000 into e power minus 1.05 will be the solution here, which is nothing but 341. If the interest rate has been constant over constant 5% for over the entire 17 year period, we would have got, I mean, we would need to deposit 427 today to become 1000 at the end of 17 years. Whereas if the interest rates were varying as per the model which we have highlighted there, we just need to deposit 349 today, or 350 today, to typically work it out to 1000 at the end of 17 years. So this is one thing we have to be comfortable with. And look at the next question. So this is a way, once we practice a couple of more numericals, you'll get a lot of hold on it. Look at this. Calculate the rate of interest per annum, convertible monthly implied by the above transaction. Let's assume for the 17 years, if I want to find out what is the interest rate convertible monthly. How do I find out what is the interest rate convertible monthly? You can very well find out the quoted rate, right? So what is that? It should come out to whatever is the quoted rate. I'll take it as 1 plus I by 12, because we are talking about monthly compounding, divided by 12 to the power 12. This is an effective annual rate, but we want the effective rate for 17 years, which means I'm taking here to the power 17, which will make it into 17 in the numerator. So the discount factor should work out to this number. Whatever is the discount rate that I am getting, it should work out to this. So basically it is nothing but 1000. When I divide by this number, it should be equal to 349.93, which means from here I should be able to find out what is that nominal rate of interest compounded monthly, which is equal to this entire deal, which means on a monthly compounding basis, what is the rate of return I am receiving on this simple investment. So let's work it out. First, for simplification, I can do 1000 by 349 as a first step. Okay, as a first step, I'm doing 1000 by this above number. 2.857 is nothing but the accumulation factor. 1 plus I12 by 12 to the power 12 into 17. So based on this, I can simplify 1 plus I12 by 12, which is nothing but this to the power 1 by 12 into 17. 1 by 12 into 17. Okay, this is working out to 1.005, which is 1 plus I12 by 12 is working out to this. So I12 by 12 becomes 1, this minus 1. So this is I12 by 12. So if I want I12, which is the nominal rate of interest, quoted nominal rate of interest annually with a quarter monthly compounding, this works out to around 6.2%. So the simple way is, if at all I had to find out the equivalent of this entire numerical, where the interest rates were fluctuating for the first 5 years on a continuously compounded kind of a basis, and after that they are constant on a continuously compounded kind of a basis, and if I have to draw the equality in terms of effective in terms of nominal rate of interest compounded monthly, it works out to this 6.19%. I hope this part of the numerical is quite comfortable. Now let's look at one more. Instead of saying that you will be receiving 1000, this question is saying we will receive, even the receipts are also 10 into e power 0.01t. We'll not receive a constant amount. We will receive 10 into e power 0.01t, between 6 and 10, right? If we are receiving a constant amount, we have taken it as 1000 directly, and we have done 1000 divided by e power whatever is the logic we have got. But here we are not receiving a constant, but we are receiving it a kind of 10 into e power 0.01t, which is a kind of a continuous stream of payment per year. It is going to come out something like this. So here we are not sure what is the amount that we are going to receive. It's not a constant amount, and it's not coming out at one single period. Different amounts are coming out at different periods of time,
between 6 to 10 per annum you are receiving at the rate of 10 into e power 0.01 into t. If that's the case, they are asking about what is the present value. So in the question, if at all you come across, the payment that is received in case of continuous stream rather than the a discrete stream like the above numerical, how do you proceed with it? So the above, the first part is the interest rate is probably, if I have to summarize it, the interest rate is continuously compounded and variable, whereas the amount that is received is one time and the duration is also fixed when you are going to receive. Whereas this numerical, okay, the interest rates are still going to be the same, whatever we have discussed above, but the amount that is going to come out is completely variable. It's not a constant amount and it changes with every year following a kind of a continuous pattern here also. Right, in these kind of numericals, how do we find out the present value? So now, just like the way we have done earlier, what we can very well do is, earlier what did we do if I wanted to find out the present value? We said we'll take it as 1000 into e power minus whatever is the T1 to T2, probably a 0 to 5.04 plus, probably let me write it here. So earlier when it was a fixed stream of payment, what did we do? We did 1000 into e power minus 0 to 5.04 plus 0.02 s ds, right? In the power itself, pi to t, we are talking about 0.05 ds, and this entire thing when we have simplified earlier, it even has come out to 1000 into e to the power of minus 0.05 t plus 0.2. Just you can refer back to the earlier simplification that we have done. Now all I am saying is this 1000, I will replace it with 10 into e power 0.01 t, because what we are getting is not 1000 now in this example, but we are getting 10 into e power 0.01 t, which is changing with time. So 1000 got replaced with this number, which means simplification wise it has simply become 10 into e to the power of 0.01 t into e to the power of minus 0.05 t into e to the power of minus 0.2. So it's as such as getting 10 into e to the power of minus 0.2 into e to the power of minus 0.04 t. This is what we have got during that period. Okay, so this is what we are going to get at one instant, but what we are saying, this amount is going to come on a continuous basis. It's not a one-time payment. Earlier the 1000 was a one-time payment, but here, this is not a one-time payment. This is going to come on a continuous basis for us, which means this amount, which is a one-time payment, has to be integrated across the entire period. So what is the integration across the entire period? I'll take it as the integration between 6 to 10. The same numbers, e power minus 0.2 into e power minus 0.04. Now this part is a constant, so I'll take it out. 10 into e power minus 0.2, whereas the integration for this is nothing but e to the power of minus 0.04 by minus 0.04 integrated between 10 and 6. So this works out to whatever the constant part is 10 into e to the power of minus 0.2 by minus 0.04. Let me do the simplification there. 10 into e to the power of minus 0.2 divided by minus 0.04. At least that simplification is coming out to minus 204. This number I have to multiply with substituting e power minus 0.04 t here or s. So if I substitute 10 and 6 in that place, what is coming out? Minus 0.4 minus e power minus 0.4 minus e power minus 0.24. So that part, e power minus 0.4 minus e power minus 0.24, which is working out to this. The multiplication of these two numbers has to come out, which is working out to around 23.80. So the present value of this entire payment stream is working out to 23.806. So in this numerical, what are the things that we are going to understand? What if the payment stream is discrete, like 1000 received after 17 years? Or what if the payment stream is continuous? The extra thing that we'll get when it is continuous is one more layer of integration. One integration at the interest rate layer to arrive at the uniform, the discounting factor for the entire period. And the second integration at the amounts layer, the reason being we are not receiving one-time payment, we are receiving a continuous stream of payments. That is where that one-time payment, whatever we have got, we have to integrate it to get a continuous stream of payments. So, there should be a little bit of more practice on this numerical, right, where the force of interest is constant versus variable. If it is variable only, we'll get all these kind of difficulties. But there, at least the amount that is getting paid or received, you have to check out whether it is a constant, one-time kind of a receipt or a continuous kind of a receipt. In that case, it becomes more and more comfortable to solve these kind of questions. Probably we'll take a similar kind of an example one more, to typically try out on a quicker note how do we operate in these kind of questions. Alright, so let's look at one more example, especially the continuous stream of payment, so that we get some more clarity in terms of solving these kind